Please welcome Professor Ono.
Well, you know, the first two talks were amazing. Jessica, Stan, thank you so much for your contributions today. I'm very touched by your work and your thoughtful comments. They will be very helpful for me moving forward in my capacity as president of UBC, but also in thinking about what we can do together to try to combat mental illness and really work to enhance the well-being of students, not only here at UBC, but also across Canada and hopefully around the world. I'm an immunologist, trained as a biochemist, and so certainly no expert, as is the case with Stan. But I want to tell you a little bit about how I got interested in mental illness and what we can do as institutions, universities, but also as governments to try to address a growing problem. Something that presidents of universities around the nation and around North America really view as an epidemic of sorts. And I can talk to you a little bit about what we're experiencing, and many of you are aware of, to really underscore the importance of what's happening today. May 18th, 2014 will be a day that I will never forget. I had been president of the University of Cincinnati since August of 2012. Things were going very, very well. Until I heard one evening when I got a phone call from the director of public safety about a young man that I had met briefly, someone that I thought was full of life, full of joy, surrounded by friends and a large, loving family. 21-year-old Brogan Dully was reported missing. The news talked about a little bit about Brogan. And as the days went by, the media coverage moved from being local to national to international. And the story about Brogan was something atypical for what would ultimately be found to be the cause of his disappearance. He was a handsome, popular young man from an affluent family in the suburbs of Cincinnati, who was a powerful swimmer and highly intelligent individual, who loved coaching kids how to swim, and the kids loved him. And he used to say to those kids when they were having problems learning how to perfect a certain stroke, he used to tell them the story about the little engine that could. You know that story, right? Because he wanted to encourage them when they were down or dispirited and to remind them that with work, dedication, they could get better. Over the days, ultimately, approximately 2,000 friends and family organized around the entire city to try to find Brogan. Coming from a large family, posters with his photograph were placed all over the city. Teams of friends from his high school, university students fanned out across the city to try to find him. Restaurants donated food. The university donated supplies and also mobilized individuals on the staff to try to find him. It was really remarkable. I have never, in the half dozen institutions that I have worked at or studied, seeing that kind of an organized effort to find one young man. Well, on May 26th, 8 days after Brogan was reported missing, his mother did something very difficult. Overcome by emotion, in front of many, many national television cameras, she called off the search because she worried about all the time and effort that friends and strangers alike were spending trying to find Brogan. But we all hoped that he would be found. And there were all kinds of thoughts about what might have happened to him. Rogan's body was found hanging in the basement in the apartment next door. The coroner was called in. The FBI was called in. And it was ruled a suicide. One of the hardest things that you have to do as president of a university, and it happens at a university of that size 10 to 15 times a year, is to go to a funeral or to lead a memorial service. And in this case, because of the international press, that memorial service was attended by thousands and was followed by a deeply moving candlelight vigil where everyone spontaneously started singing Amazing Grace. It was incredible. It was a worldwide news story. In the process, I got to know everyone in the entire family. Each one of them was amazing. They loved their brother tremendously, and the parents are probably the most devoted and loving parents I have ever met over many years as a university administrator. What did they do? And why am I telling you the story other than to underscore a growing problem at our institutions? Well, they jumped into action, and they started a program that spread across the United States called 8 Days of Greatness to thank the thousands of people over those 8 days who looked for their son, Rogan. Students and others organized a run where thousands of people raised money to treat mental illness, to help deal with this growing problem at our schools called the Rogan Delhi Warrior Run. And as I got more and more involved in this conversation, I was invited one day to go to Indian Hill, an even more affluent suburb in Cincinnati, a fundraiser to try to raise much-needed funds to enhance the number of counselors at schools to really do the research so that we can do the right thing. And I decided at that event to attack something else, and that was the fact that people didn't want to talk about the problem. And I started, when I went there, and this is probably on YouTube, expecting to talk about my brother's battles with mental illness and depression, and the fact that as a brilliant mathematician, one day he almost swerved his car into an 18-wheel truck on one rainy day when he was despairing about the progress of his career. And what ended up happening, actually, is that, as many of you know, because it's been a lot written about it, I decided that the only way to be honest and transparent and to break the stigma was for me to talk about my own challenges with mental health. And so I talked about the attempts on my own life as a young adult, hoping that coming from a position of strength and authority, that it might actually help break the silence and attack stigma that is inhibiting the kind of conversation that was really needed to make progress. What happened was really remarkable. I had no idea that it would get the kind of media attention that it did, had no idea that it would go viral. But a lot of good things happened from that day moving forward. First, it really stimulated a conversation at the university, where we really tripled the amount of mental health counseling around the university. And lots of faculty and staff and students wrote to me saying, thank you for breaking the silence, because now we can speak about our problems. And the students themselves, as often happens, they mobilized. And there was an event on national television where they all held yellow pieces of paper so that the entire football stadium full of 40,000 people, that half of the individuals were holding up that card so that people could visually see that one half of the university students were struggling with mental illness, so that people could visually see it, so that we could visually break the silence. It was remarkable. I then received an email from President Obama to attend one of his White House summits on mental health. And one thing led to another, and more presidents started to get involved And there were articles written, not only in the lay press, but in the Chronicle of Higher Education and otherwise. And there has been, in the United States, an increased attention on this issue, with many universities, starting in Ohio, but going across the United States, with many universities really doubling down and trying to deal with this growing epidemic. And the University of British Columbia has been a leader, just this year, tripling the number of counselors that are available for the students that are at our risk. And that well-being programs are really at the center of what we're trying to do as a university, to reach proactively out to the students to try to tackle the problem before it gets out of hand. It is a real problem. At many of the institutions, including those that I've led, there's been a 43% jump in the past 5 years in students seeking counseling. And that's even before our efforts to try to mobilize and encourage students to seek counseling. De novo, on their own, the numbers are escalating. And that story is not a Cincinnati-specific problem. It's not a UBC-specific problem. It's something that we see around North America. If you look at the data, not only are the numbers of students seeking counseling growing in an exponential level over the past several years, but there are so many severe cases which are much more frequent when they present themselves in counseling centers. And the causes for this increase in students seeking counseling are not completely understood and certainly cannot be explained by an immunologist such as myself. But the focus groups that we held in Cincinnati might give some sort of a clue as to some of those stresses. And some of them are common to what we experienced when we were going to university. Issues of love life, family issues, lack of acceptance by a father figure or a mother. In some cases, a long history of psychological and psychiatric issues. Economic challenges, Jessica, you talked about that in terms of first-generation students with the increasing cost of college. In many cases, the students said it was that economic pressure that was really the last straw that broke their backs. There's a recent phenomenon of social media. There's a real phenomenon of stalking and harassment that occurs through social media, which certainly didn't exist when we were in university, many of us. And the other thing that many people say, many of the students say in their focus groups, is what we would call helicopter parenting, where students have been there with their parents along the way, so they have never experienced failure. And once that they're released onto the campus, they're so afraid to fail and don't know what to do that it adds and compounds the stress that they face. The good news is that at UBC and Cincinnati and Ohio State, what makes me optimistic is there has been a proliferation of programs used to try to deal with this. In many cases, tripling the number of counselors, stress relief programs, therapy dogs that the students love, enhanced student at risk training for faculty and residence life staff so that people know when they're looking at a situation of mental illness, so that they're trained to detect it. And lots of proactive things, such as workshops, yoga sessions, peer training, so that the students near them can recognize when there is a student at risk. Online training programs, group therapy. More research needs to be done, rigorous research, to determine which ones of these can actually be effective. But the biggest message I want to leave all of you is that we have this problem. There is momentum and progress, but we need to be more organized, not only at the single institutional unit level, but at the province level, the national level, and at the institutional level. I can tell you, being a university president of two major research universities, that we're just starting to figure out how to recognize and take care of young individuals, students, that are at risk. And what gives me the most hope is that when I attend groups of presidents at conferences, that this is front and center now among our priorities. It is front and center as a UBC priority. And universities Canada, similar organizations in the United States, are really focusing to try to come up with multi-year strategies to deal with this epidemic. Thank you very much.